Namaskar and welcome after the break. You're watching Rajneeti with me, Darshini Joshi, and as I very proudly said today, we have a Padma Shri sitting with us here in the United Kingdom. Padma Shri, Shri Bob Blackman. Welcome back after the break, Bob. As we were talking about different things in terms of your achievements with the Indian diaspora, there are certain things which might seem as certain challenges for you. With Preeti Patel at the helm, talking about very sort of difficult issues such as immigration. Will the Conservatives maintain their stance of controlling immigration? You know, the Labour was saying, oh, you know, they just want to say yes, yes to everything. And in terms of students and, you know, people coming in from the subcontinent into these so-called schools and colleges here, do you get complaints about them, and are we dealing with those?
Yeah, I mean, let's be clear. We inherited a position whereby there were huge backlogs back in 2010, huge backlogs of people applying for settled status in the UK that are already here. There are other people that wanted to come here. So it was a complete disaster by the time 2010 rolled around. Now we're 10 years on. Controlling immigration has meant that because we could not control immigration from the European Union, we had to control immigration very severely from outside the European Union. Now we're moving to a position whereby everyone across the world will be treated equally. When we're moving to a points-based immigration system, so in other words,
like Australia, yeah.
Similar to Australia, we haven't formulated it yet, but we'll be in a position whereby people that are, particularly in the medical field, for example, people who are qualified will get a medical type visa, because we need doctors and nurses that are well qualified to come here and help in our National Health Service. But in other cases, it will be on what skills and capabilities people have from wherever you are. And I suspect that we'll be in a position whereby for India, it will be far better as a system, because there are so many highly skilled people in India who want to come and live and work here. So I think that will be good news for India. In terms of students, when I was elected in 2010, immigration minister came to me and said, Bob, do you realise you have in your constituency, just my constituency of Harrow East, 200 colleges? So I said, you're joking. And most of those colleges were a sham. They were offices above shops where students were attracted from India. They were given a visa and then they arrived, walked in, their papers were stamped and they were told, right, now you can go off and work in the local curry house, the local supermarket or wherever. It was a means to avoid the immigration system.
That's right.
And they actually didn't get anything for it. And they were paying fees for these sham colleges. So the government closed all those down, basically took those away. I feel really sorry for people that came here, were charged fees by these sham
and
colleges.
Really high ones.
Yes, exactly. And therefore they were left high and dry. The problem now is one of, we've obviously got an immigration system whereby we want to attract genuine students to genuine colleges. And there is a problem still that, of course, Indian students who want to come and study here apply for a place and they don't know if they've got a place, and then they get a place, but it's dependent on them having a visa. They don't apply for a visa until they know they've got a place. And then it takes time to get the visa. So there's a decision to be made. The good news is that the number of applications last year has increased, I think it's by 68% from India. And we've got a position now whereby compliance, i.e. people that come here from India and study, return home in about 98% of cases.
Right.
And that demonstrates that actually people can be trusted to come here and study and then go back home. If they want to work, then they get a job here on a post-study basis. We increase the length of time that they've got to get a job.
From what to what?
I think it's 6 months to a year now.
Okay.
So people have got chance then to get a job after they've completed their studies of a degree level standard or above, so that people can stay here and work, which is good news. Because I think one of the problems we had was that Indian students were starting to say, well, I'd rather go to the USA or to Australia because it's easier to get into colleges in those places and get visas. We've changed that round now. And I think that's a message that we've got to send strongly to the Indian diaspora here, to communicate back to their family and friends in India that actually Britain is open for business, and it's clearly that's one of the key messages. I mean, I personally, and this comes back to your immigration issue, I get lots and lots of immigration queries and concerns, and I just find it wrong in principle that someone in somewhere in the European Union could just get on a plane and arrive here and we can do nothing about it. But if someone is in Ahmedabad or wherever, and they said, well, I want to go to England to actually visit my relatives, then you fill in a visa form, you provide proof that you've got money to support yourself to be here, you've got a reason to return, and then an entry clearance officer can still say, well, I don't believe you, and reject your visa request. Well, that to me in principle is wrong.
There is no equality.
Rules should apply everywhere and equally. And I think one of the things that will happen as we leave the European Union, and then we impose the same conditions to anyone that wants to come here, whether they're coming from India or from Romania or one of the Eastern European countries, the same rules will apply. Well, that's the right way. That's the way it should be.
So obviously a lot of the viewers who are watching us here today will have this question, because you know, they're probably, some of them will be older and they won't understand this. So explain to us, if people are kind of being monitored to come into the country, what happens to those Indians or British citizens that want to go to the European Union? And how long will that process take to implement?
Well, it's an agreement that basically people can go and visit any countries in the European Union. They've got to pay £5 for a equivalent of a visa. It's basically a visa to go visit the European Union, and that lasts for 3 years. So from that perspective, I don't think that's an unreasonable charge.
Yeah, it's like the ESTA kind of.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like a visa waiver system that applies to if you apply to go to the United States from here, or Canada, or one of the other countries. That's the sort of charge that you're talking about. I think that's perfectly reasonable. If you want to go, what we're trying to do is make sure that we have reciprocal rights for EU citizens coming here and for UK citizens going to the EU.
Okay, so obviously this is going to take time to implement.
Yes.
31st January is like literally tomorrow, day after. How long will this Brexit process take, in your opinion?
Well, I think the immigration system is likely, I mean, where we are, we leave on the 31st of January, and that means we've left the political union. We then have the rest of 2020 to negotiate hopefully the free trade deal that we'll do with the European Union, mm-hmm. and other arrangements such as security, which are in both the European Union's interest and our interest. And then we've got the immigration system that we want to set up. We think that's going to take till 2021 to introduce, and then from then on in it will be an equal basis across the world. The big thing that will happen, I think, after the 1st of February, is our international trade department has been negotiating with partners across the world trade deals that we can implement quickly. So for example, there will be trade deals announced, I think, very quickly for Australia, New Zealand, Canada, might take a bit longer for Canada, but also Israel and other Commonwealth countries. At the moment, of course, we don't have a trade deal with India because the European Union has been obstructive for 22 years.
So positive sign.
So I am pressing my colleagues in the International Trade Department to say, well, let's sit down and do a trade deal with India, because we don't have to worry about things like reservations on champagne or Mercedes-Benz cars or whatever. We can concentrate on what suits
mangoes.
The UK. Or mangoes. Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, well, yeah, I think the I kicked up a fuss about this. Keith Vaz, who was in Parliament, kicked up a big fuss about this. And, we've said, well, hang on, wait a minute, this is not right. What's the issue here? So I think from that perspective, we've got a chance, I think, of negotiating a trade deal with India, particularly with the Indian government as they are now, looking outwardly for improving the economy of India, looking at making things in India, as well as investing abroad, because after all, we're the third biggest investor in India, and India is the third biggest investor in the UK.
Correct.
So already we have that position without a trade deal. So just think what we can do if we've got a trade deal.
So obviously the reason why the Conservative Party won the general elections, and quite strongly so, is because of its policies. One doesn't have to sort of go into too much research about it, but clearly we noticed that the stance pretty much remained the same. There was nothing extremist in the outlook. We struggled to understand where Labour was coming from and their views on calling countries like India extremist supporters. But then again, you know what? Indians made a choice here. Now, in terms of the shift, do you see that? I want to come back to the Brexit topic again, because I want to talk about the trade embargoes and stuff like that, but more talk about smaller markets.
Yes.
But let me first ask you, has there been a paradigm shift, or has there been a shift in allegiances of Indians from Labour to Conservative? And has it been really there, or is it just talk, you think?
I think, well, my personal belief is that the Indian diaspora in the UK has always predominantly voted Labour.
Yes.
Particularly those people that arrived in this country as immigrants, so the first generation.
But Clement Attlee time.
Well, not Clement Attlee time. I'm going a bit sort of later in 1970s.
Okay. 70s, okay.
I think a lot of those people, even though it was a Conservative government under Ted Heath, that brought people here, even though they tended to vote Labour. And the reason for that, I think we should be quite clear, is that the parties, the Labour Party at a local level, put their arms around the Indian community arriving and say, well, we'll give you a community centre, we'll give you this, we'll give you that, and in return you give us your vote. Mm. And I think there was a trade-off then, and unfortunately I think my party, and of course I wasn't active in politics at that time, I was still at school, but my party got it wrong, because what we should have done is reach out to people who we had helped to come here in the first place, and enabled them when they couldn't return to India. Remember, the Indian government said, no, you can't come back. So from that perspective, we made a home for them, and they have built the economy, because those people came and they were professionals, but they ran corner shops, they saw an opening in the market. People don't realise this, but if you go back to the 1970s, our shops opened about 9 o'clock, they closed at five.
There was nothing.
They were closed on Wednesday afternoons, they were open Saturdays and closed all day Sundays. I mean, people now say, well, hang on a minute, what people saw was an opportunity. Well, we'll open longer, we'll open small shops on Sundays, when it's convenient, when people want to shop. Mm-hmm. You know, that's business, isn't it? And they made their money, they wanted their children to succeed at school, so they could actually go on and become professionals and put roots down in this country. And so as the generations have gone on, I think people who are born in this country and educated in this country are more, and then made a living as professionals, are far more likely to say, yes, I forget Indian politics and politics of the subcontinent, concentrate on what's good for me here. And obviously the policies of the Conservative Party, which are economically to support business, to support people standing on their own 2 feet, that to encourage people to get a job, to encourage the extended family and looking after people. You translate all those values. They are natural Indian values. Our problem in the Conservative Party has been to translate that to the Indian diaspora, who've gone, okay, but we're still going to vote Labour because they look after us. Yes. And that's been a problem. And I think in 2010, we started to make inroads in a big way in that community. In 2015, for the first time, the majority of British Indians voted Conservative.
Yes.
Now, we went backwards in 2017, all sorts of reasons, but we made a great leap forward in 2019. Now, the key point here is that there were two things. One is, I think people were attracted to our policies economically, and for their families in terms of education, in terms of the health service, in terms of what it meant for business and taxation and so on, because we passionately believe that people should keep more of their own money to make their own decisions in life and then stand on their own 2 feet rather than the state providing everything for them. That's one of the fundamental
things. Yes, because as a country, India
absolutely
does not get any handouts.
No, absolutely.
And, I'll share this honestly with you. When I first came into this country 21 years ago, I was of the belief, oh, I've left my homeland, my motherland, and there was all this, you know, patriotic feeling going on. But when I integrated into the society, I took the society on board. It took me 10 years,
yeah.
And I said, I'm going to go for my British citizenship. And when I even did you know, when you do the oath and you do the course, I learned so much about this country and how welcoming it has been. And people like you who want to, you know, sort of support and help us. I now call myself British. I cannot say to myself, oh, I'm Indian. And I think that people who are watching this program, one of the things that conservatives have done and people like Bob Blackman have done is to say to you, look, if you're contributing to the economy, if you're doing good, then we will help businesses. Like we have families, I have families who are news agents, and I have families who are lawyers and doctors and accountants. And we feel that your policies now kind of resonate with our lives. So thank you for making that change. And I hope people listening and watching will start understanding that we're not just working in unskilled stuff, but we're doing skilled and professional services now.
And I think the other issue, yes, which was very important in this process, was the Labour Party's decision to pass a conference resolution attacking
that was heartbreaking
India, attacking India over Jammu and Kashmir. Now the reality is that what went around, it was like a thunderclap amongst the Indian diaspora to say, okay, you do this, we're going to say to all of our people, don't vote Labour. You know, you're not going to say we'll vote Conservative or vote for another party, just don't vote Labour. That gave us an opportunity to speak to people directly and say, please vote for us. Mm. And this is why. So instead of people, I think, routinely just voting the way they used to vote, they now thought, well, okay, fine, well, let's consider, which gave us the opening to actually talk to people about why it would be sensible for them to vote for us. And I think that's why, we haven't seen the figures yet, but I suspect a very large number of the Indian diaspora in the UK voted Conservative, probably for the first time.
Yes.
The challenge for us now is to say, you've lent us your vote, now how can we make sure you vote for us each election? Because one of the problems for the Indian diaspora is, as we all know, they don't always vote. You know, if they may routinely go out and vote Labour. This time they said, no, we won't do that. Now they've tripped out.
We all, myself, my friends, my family, we categorically went out to vote because we wanted to make a stand.
Yeah.
We wanted to talk about supporting what is right and what is correct. And you very rightly said that. My question to you here, don't know if we're going to go into a break very soon, but I wanted to ask you, and I want you to talk to me about it a bit more, so that people watching us today understand what is it that we can do to sort of integrate a bit more, or do you think that we've done well so far and we just need to make sure we educate ourselves more in terms of policies and going out to vote?
I think the most important thing is that the Indian population of the UK is heavily integrated into society. It's in every profession, it's involved in business, it stands on its own two feet. It's the most likely people to be victims of crime rather than perpetrators of crime. It's got the lowest percentage of population in prison of any racial or religious group.
That's good to know.
It's good, but it also demonstrates that people are law-abiding and getting on with their lives. I think the big issue now is to actually get heavily involved in politics directly.
Mm.
And that's by joining the party. I mean, I obviously would ask everyone to join the Conservative Party, naturally, but actually getting involved in the parties, political party of your choice, actually getting involved, becoming a member, getting involved in branches, getting involved in the politics that happen, and then going on to become a local representative on the council, going on to become a representative on assemblies, going on to apply to become members of parliament, because that is the way that the community makes their next step, which is not just being involved, but actually influencing and being directly responsible for the policies. I mean, as you quite rightly say, we've got now three cabinet ministers of Indian origin. Well, that's remarkable. That's never happened.
Never happened
before. But we'll see more. Why not? I mean, people who excel in business or in their professions should go on to excel in politics.
That's sort of very crystal clear. And I think that as we are going for a break, I would like you to think about something. To come to a country like Great Britain and for the government and the political scenario led by the leader, Boris Johnson, to invite members of your diaspora to be a part of the change or the political system at the top tier is a huge step for us. So we should give ourselves a pat on the back, and of course you for always being there for us. We're going to go for a short break here on Rajneeti, but stay tuned, we'll be right back. Thank you.